Well, I think so. I think, yes, we are live. Well, it's given me a bar. So I think we are. Sometimes it starts like this in the video where it's just me saying, I think so, but I think we are. So everybody, whether you are watching us on Facebook Live or if you are here in the Zoom room with us, I just want to double check. Yes, we are. Okay, good, good, good. So again, welcome everybody. Thank you for being here with us. Thank you, Ernest, for organizing this course and putting all of this work into it. I do want to read off a statement and thank some people just before we dive in, but my name is Cheyenne Raquel Farley and I coordinate the Education and Community Action Programs for Academia Theater. This course, as well as some of our other community care circles, have truly been some of my most favorite parts of my job, especially during this pandemic. I've learned a lot, I've grown a lot, and I've been able to engage with the community, even though we're all separated, some of us all the way in Austria, but still we are engaging together and we are learning and growing together. So I do want to first thank the National Endowment for the Arts, who without we wouldn't be able to offer these programs for free to our community, as well as the Dallas Office of Arts and Culture for their continued support of Academia Theater, who again, without their continued support, we wouldn't be able to offer these programs for free to our community, open to the public. Here we are all learning together during these difficult times. One last thing, I do want to quickly read over a land acknowledgement before we begin. So I would like to recognize the Native people whose ancestral lands are where Academia Theater operates. We wish to acknowledge the land of the Kickapoo, Tawakoni, Wichita, and Caddo people, which is now called Dallas. Comanches and Kiowa have also lived in this region, although it is not often recognized as their homeland. We acknowledge that Dallas is stolen land and that this is a city that was built by stolen labor. Academia Theater's community care circles, including this course this evening, honor the experiences and cultures of Black, Indigenous, and people of color, and we call for the unity and solidarity of all of our peoples in making a better world. So without further ado, I will pass things over to veteran human rights activist and phenomenal person, Ernest McMillan.
Cheyenne, thank you for that kickoff for what I think is going to be a great conversation tonight. And double thanks for making the affirmation, making us aware and embracing the fact that we are standing on stolen land and where stolen labor and stolen lives have taken place over the centuries. Thank you for honoring our ancestors too. I believe we're in for a real treat tonight. We have gone through two of three courses, and we have one more following this one. The whole thing about becoming a light unto yourself and to others has been our theme throughout this. And we covered for the first round, a talk with Ty Defoe, who's a Native American who has helped us understand the need for becoming more open and available and receptive and active in promoting inter-ethnicity and interculturalism. And so he gave us a spark of a light to help us find ways to do that. We had our second course with John Fullwinder and also Ileana Valdez, who were representative of the Boomer generation and the Z generation, talking about how we can become better associated, more open to having the blurred lines between the ages and generations. And they gave us examples from their life story, from their history, from their practices themselves and some of the things they've run against that help impede that work. Tonight we're in for a treat. We're going to look at interfaith development. How can we come closer, blur the lines to work as brothers and sisters, as human beings, as earthlings, working together for a better world, regardless of the faith or religious background. And we have with us a gentleman who is I'm honored to have with us, Dr. Robert Hunt. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about him in just a minute. But first, I just want to invite you to sit down just a moment. And there's a song being played by John Coltrane called Welcome. You are truly welcome to this conversation tonight. I want you to open your hearts, open your minds, to relax, to get comfortable, and to take in what we have to hear from this great wise man who has devoted his time to us tonight, and also to be free, feel free to be able to express yourself. We have plenty of time for that. Again, this poem by John Coltrane is called Welcome, and it represents to me the spirit of that we want to convey tonight of welcoming one another. That is a treasure. I needed that myself. So I hope you're able to feel the vibe. Our guest tonight, I wish to introduce to you now, is a man born in Dallas, Texas, has become a world traveler. He's lived in the Philippines and Malaysia and Austria, and he's made great contributions to the thoughts and experiences for people coming together around the world. He's been a teacher, educator, and a pastor, been a author of several books. He's right now, he's in Austria, in Vienna, Austria, and it's early morning there. And I just want to thank him for making time. This was not planned, but we'll find out more about his journey to Vienna tonight. But I want to welcome you. I want to leave with one of the quotes that inspired me to reach out to him. He says this, and it comes from his heart too. He says, I believe that every person, culture, and society has something valuable to offer to others, and that we discover this through critical and appreciative study, open dialogue, and a willingness to learn. So without any further ado, I want you to help me welcome Dr. Robert Hunt, who is now a professor of world religions at the School of Perkins School of Theology in SMU here in Dallas. Welcome, Brother Hunt.
Thank you very much. I appreciate being here, Ernest, and to have this opportunity. That was a beautiful introduction to the show, both the statement recognizing the realities of the Dallas that we live in, and also the Coltrane piece, of course.
Thank you. But look, I'm just amazed that you're here with us. It didn't really plan this way, but I know you're now in Austria. Could you tell us a little bit about your travel? What are you doing there? What's the weather like? Tell us what's going on there right now.
Well, we're in Austria. I'll go back a few steps from this. In 1978, I met my wife Lillian, who is a native of Malaysia, ethnic Chinese native of Malaysia, and we decided that when we got married, that we would go and work there. And we went in early 1985, as missionaries of the General Board of Global Ministries. And we worked first in the Philippines for about 6 months while we waited for a visa. And then we were in Malaysia for 7 years. We took a year off while I finished my PhD at the University of Malaya. Then we were 4 years in Singapore at Trinity Theological College. And then the mission board wanted someone to pastor a very diverse church in Vienna, Austria. And they needed someone who spoke German, which I theoretically did. And you don't know how well you speak the language till you actually have to. But And they wanted someone who was used to working in a very complex multicultural context. And so we moved to Vienna, and I was the pastor of the English-speaking Methodist Church. I continued teaching at Webster University, where I taught international relations and world religions. I'll mention that the congregation I had in Vienna was itself a very challenging. Malaysia and Singapore were multi-ethnic countries. They had no majority. The largest minority was Malay, Muslim. Christians were dominantly Chinese and ethnic Chinese and ethnic Indians and ethnic indigenous peoples, but we only made up about 6% of the population. And then there were Hindus and Buddhists as well. So everything in Malaysia was worked out on a daily basis in two or three languages and with multiple ethnicities. There was never a day that, especially if you were European, there were many days that you didn't see any other Europeans or people of European descent. But nobody ever woke up one day and only saw people who looked like them or who spoke their same language. It wasn't the nature of the society. Austria was quite a bit different. It was my first experience in two important ways. One was my congregation, the largest single group in the congregation were West Africans, primarily from Ghana and Nigeria. And that was about 35 or 40% of the congregation. There were also those Sierra Leonese, Ugandans, Kenyans, South Africans, Cote d'Ivoire, you name it, Congolese. And then the rest of the congregation came from everywhere. Many people worked for the United Nations. But the other thing about the Vienna experience for me was it reintroduced me to the need for interfaith dialogue that involved the Jewish people. Austria is a fraught place for this. There was very little in the way of interfaith dialogue involving Jews in Malaysia and Singapore. In fact, such Jews as lived in Malaysia lay low to the ground in that dominantly Muslim country. Austria was a bit different. And it was critically important, I think, there to be engaged with the Jewish community, but also the Muslim community, because when we arrived in Austria, there was a war going on just to the south and the east of us with the breakup of the former Yugoslavia. And of course, part of that war involved the Bosniak Muslim population. And the neighborhood in Vienna where I lived in, if we want to talk about a complex neighborhood, the church that I pastored and I lived above the church, essentially in an apartment, you have to imagine a really European center city, right? With just rows and rows of houses and shops and things. But I was within a 5-minute walk of the Mannerheim or the men's hostel where Adolf Hitler had lived in Vienna. It was a very short walk, actually, and the hostel was still operating. It's not anymore, but it was at the time. The neighborhood that I lived in was dominantly Turkish Muslim, I used to say it was an easy place to learn German because we were all speaking it badly together. It was our bad common language, and we were only third of a mile, maybe half a mile at the most, from what had been the great synagogue of Vienna that was destroyed in Kristallnacht. So you're in an old city, you're in old with a history of both incoming migrants bringing their new religious traditions, a history of conflict and refugees, and our church worked almost primarily with refugees. And a church that had a history of serious religious violence against the Jewish people in particular. Although to tell the truth, we don't think of this in our American context. I'm a United Methodist. Methodism was actually against the law in Austria until 1956, when a new post-war constitution established freedom of religion. Prior to that time, you had to be a recognized religion. And every Methodist pastor up until the 50s in Austria served time in jail. So there was some history there. Then we were here 7 years, long enough to explain why I'm here now, that my children became at home. They went through their high school years and college years. My daughter, as it happened, would later return here to do graduate school, marry an Austrian, and so our grandchildren are here. That's why we're here right now. We were finally able to get here, shut down Europe. After that, we moved back to the United States and to Dallas. I took my job at Southern Methodist University. And a couple of things, and Ernest, I think these will maybe lead into the questions you wanted to ask. A couple of the things jumped out at me right away. The first was that Dallas and Richardson had changed since I had grown up. Dallas had become far more obviously multi-ethnic and multilingual, and far, far more multi-religious. I was in Richardson as a junior high and high schooler. They used to call Richardson a city of churches. When I moved back in 2005, the Richardson School District, by the way, we thought the exotic thing that happened when I was in high school was that they integrated the Richardson school system and closed down Hamilton Park School. And that was like going to be a big trauma, right? That we all of a sudden had to go to school with people who weren't the same color as us. Actually, it turned out to be not that bad. Let me put it, it was equally traumatic for everybody. By the time I moved back in 2005, Richardson School District had 72 different languages spoken in the school district. It was much more ethnically diverse, but it also had, and I've counted them every year, Richardson now has at least 7 mosques. It has at least 8 Buddhist temples. Now, some of these are quite small, right? It has a Sikh Gurdwara. It has 2 Hindu temples, at least. And what really hit home for me, if you want to talk about the way things are changing, is that my old home church, First United Methodist Church of Richardson, sold its very large campus to build an even larger campus on the highway. But the people who are now worshiping in the church I grew up in are the Tsuchi Buddhist Foundation and Chinese school. So Dallas has changed. It's a different world. But what struck me in 2005, to be honest, was that there wasn't much in the way of interreligious dialogue going on in Dallas, given these huge changes. And even more importantly, or maybe as importantly at least, I think dialogue that extended across ethnic lines, and in particular Christian-Jewish dialogue, seemed to have fallen off entirely. So maybe that'll get us into where we are in Dallas now with both ecumenism, Christians talking to Christians, yes, and interfaith. So I'll hand it over to you. That's a little of my background.
Well, no, I'm loving hearing that like you are a world traveler. There's an old saying that where home is where you go, and they got to let you in. So like there's many
right
around the world that they got to let you in Malaysia and Austria. Dallas, all over. So your home is an expanded version for you, right?
That's right. Well, they would let me in, but I had to have a COVID test.
Okay. Got to get that test. Okay.
Yes,
yeah. In this world where we see so many signs of hope that you've expressed of people living and working together, at the same time, there seems to be a growing intolerance, a growing reaction to immigration or shifts in technology and divisions of labor and so forth, that I'm wondering what may be triggering these things. It seems to be the what they call the populist or ultra-right wing seems to have a growing trend throughout the world, and Brazil and Philippines and in the United States, even in Europe, certain parts of Europe, in Hungary, for example, where there seems to be a growing trend for hatred or fear or warmongering. And even in the Muslim world, I've seen where young girls are killed by their own parents because they call it honor killings, because they may be dating or interested in someone outside of their faith. So what do you see happening that from this negative side, this apparent growth of intolerance and hatred toward people simply because of their race and their faith? Sorry.
Mm-hmm. No, that's fine. You know, what has struck me since returning to the U.S., I guess in 15 years, I've begun to be acclimatized again to American culture. I can still say with honesty, I've lived more of my adult life outside the U.S. than inside. But is that all of the high ideals that were talked about when I was in school, that the United States was a melting pot and that we, you know, everybody give me your tired, your poor, your wretched masses yearning to be free. What happened in the 20th century was people took us up in the United States on that and came, settled, helped the success of our nation, but also changed the way it looked. And I think in the United States context, what we're seeing is a reaction to the fact that within a generation or half a generation, older Americans in particular, and I guess I have to conclude myself in that, don't see their neighborhoods look the way they thought they would see them. And they really, I would call this a spiritual problem. They went to church, but they went to segregated churches for all practical purposes, let's be honest. They went to school, but you know, we know that after that first wave of the integration of schools, that schools have gradually begun to be more segregated again. They didn't have the experience I had of going to school with people who looked different. I'd grown up in Texas long enough, all over Texas, that I was used to hearing a couple of different languages. My parents both spoke Spanish as well as English. They're Anglos, obviously, but they had lived in Mexico. But a lot of people grew up only hearing one language. And I think they weren't spiritually prepared for the United States becoming what the United States had always promised to be. and I think that's part of the reaction. I'll be honest, it's a reaction I emotionally cannot understand. You know, my daughter is married to a Jewish Austrian. My son is married to a Croatian Catholic. I've lived my whole life with people who didn't look like me. And until I moved back to the U.S., was always a member of a small religious minority. But I think this is part of it. And I'll say this too. It is happening worldwide, by the way. But again, it's largely pressured by migration. It's the fact of our 21st century world that we have large flows and movements of people, and that our economies really depend on that. We actually need people to move around for us to be as successful as we are. And that's true in the United States. It's also true in Austria, where I am right now. It's true of Eastern Europe. It's true of Hungary, although Hungarians don't want to admit it. Germany, for example, and France, huge numbers of what they call guest workers who've come in France from Morocco or North Africa. In Germany, they've come from Turkey. These economies couldn't survive without these workers. And neither could the American economy. So that's part of our reality, but I think it's a part of reality that many people weren't prepared for. And then of course we have the rise of this populist hatred, and it is, you're right, it's worldwide, Ernest. You hear it everywhere. And I think, I'm not a political pundit, but I think political parties and the media, and maybe especially social media, let that rhetoric get out of hand. Maybe we could just say we as Americans let that rhetoric get out of hand. We didn't call it early enough. We didn't push back early enough. And as a result, it's now, you know, it's lit a fire. And you know what they say in the Bible, you sow the wind and you reap the whirlwind. Well, our politicians sowed the wind thinking they could use it to their advantage. Our media sowed the wind thinking that it would bring more interest and commercial value. And now we're reaping a whirlwind. And it's hard to put that genie back in the bottle.
And it seems like the conditions that caused this movement to happen are not going to lessen or die down in it, because I'm told at least 80 million people are stateless without a country.
That's right.
Because of drought and storms and floods and all the climate change that people are forced to move, as well as wars and starvation and things like that, causing people to move. So I really think we got to get a handle on this, because this is really a growing trend in the world today. We have to grasp. In my day, Sunday was the most segregated day of the week, you know, where everybody was in their church and had their own little bubble and so forth. I want to just step back a moment. You let a whole lot on me, but I want to just step back a moment and look at what's happening within the Christian churches. Mm-hmm. There's no monolith. There's all kinds of denominations and so forth. I'm wondering, do you see any coming together, sharing within, before we look at the interfaith, let's look at what's happening within the Christian churches and Catholic, Baptist, Methodist, whatever, Lutheran and all. Do you see any coming together, an ecumenical movement happening today in Dallas or in around the world or anywhere to point to this, gives us sign to seeing some real change taking place?
I think the ecumenical movement has become a good deal more complicated than it was. There was a time when churches got together in councils of churches for different cities and towns, and then those were often in a national organization like the National Council of Churches, or for some of the more evangelical churches that didn't want to play with that in that sandbox, they had their own evangelical sandbox, but at least we were talking to each other. And certainly at a local level, it didn't matter. You Methodists talked to Baptists and Catholics and everyone. Those movements do continue, and they continue in positive ways. It's unfortunate that Dallas does not have what it used to have, a ministerial alliance of any sort, of our ecumenical movement at a city level. And there's a sad and unfortunate history behind that. But a lot of it's driven by the fact that Dallas is so religious. We're such a city of mega churches that that people are strong by themselves, so they don't need to be strong together. That's kind of our problem. I think you'd find if you go to the suburbs or you go to rural Texas, you'll find that pastors get together a lot more because none of them have so much strength that they can stand alone. So I think the ecumenical movement's grown more complex, but it remains important. And the thing that I think Christians have to do, which speaks specifically to Christians, and really people of other faiths who want to work with Christians, is to look for where the networks are in your place, to look where they're actually built. The old big worldwide national institutions really have broken down a great deal. But almost every place you go, there's something happening locally. And I'll talk more about that later when we talk about interfaith. There are things happening locally that pastors and church members can hook into and get involved with that bring the different Christian groups together. The other thing, of course, is, and this has always been true, Ernest, you can talk to your neighbors. You can get to know those folks that live around you, and you can encourage your own pastor to say, look, if we're going to work in this neighborhood, let's talk to those Baptists and the Pentecostals and the Roman Catholic Church down the street. We don't have to be strangers. They have a phone number. but I think a lot of it's come down to local initiatives, and we just have to tune into those local initiatives.
Yeah, I think local work is important, and acting locally and thinking globally is kind of
absolutely
where you have to really practice what you preach where you are. I'm wondering, do you see the churches growing and responding to the changes in terms of attendance? I know with the pandemic and all, you can't really have these church filled. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, even before that, were you seeing any tendencies for the church to becoming more openly, more increasing in their membership and their activities, or what kind of trends have you seen?
Well, the trends have been very carefully documented in the United States and even worldwide by the Pew Foundation. And so they make reports available. I usually rely on theirs. There's another group, David Barrett, but here's the trend in the United States. The actual number of Christians and religious people generally is staying about the same, over the last 20 years. But our population has grown. So the number of Christians there are as a percentage of population is actually declining. And so that's why you can see really, you can see healthy churches. They're not dying, but they're just not growing. And much of the growth that you do see when churches get much bigger is people who are moving from one church to this other church. So we have the phenomenon of smaller churches getting smaller and then fading from existence. But that doesn't mean people have gone away. It just means they've probably gone to one of these much larger churches. Go ahead, Ernest.
You think that's a part of just the demographic changes in housing patterns and so forth? Is that driving that kind of thing?
I think demographics drive it. As neighborhoods become more diverse, it's often hard for these basically monolithic, monocultural churches to figure out how to do ministry in a diverse area. So it turns out that everybody in the neighborhood travels to a church somewhere outside that looks like them. Some churches get it, don't get me wrong, but it's not easy. And I know that from having myself pastored for 7 years of totally multicultural church. You got to work at it. You got to love it. That's the demographic trend. The more troubling demographic trend is that among young people, people under the age of 35, there's a rapid drop off in being actively religious in any way, but particularly in the United States, of being actively Christian. Something over 35 or 40% of young people under the age of 40, do not affiliate with any religion. And not only do not affiliate with any religion, but are a generation away from having affiliated with the religion. Mm. So they really don't know anything about religion except what they see on popular media. Obviously, some of us are going to get the religious part of our nation is getting older and will die. The younger part of our nation is not religious. That doesn't bode well. And by the way, it affects all the religions. All the religions. We see this phenomenon among Muslims. Even though the Muslim community is growing, that's primarily growth because of large families and first and second generation immigrants. Third generation Muslims are as likely to be non-religious as are Christians and Jews. That has been the trend. And one of the things that it really calls the churches to do, I can't speak for any other religion but Christianity, is figure out what's happened to the young people. I'll give a quick answer to that if you want me to, or what I think is.
You step. Yes.
Okay. I think young people who've grown up in the United States in the last, since 1990, let's say, so I'd be up to 30 years old, have grown up in a multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-religious environment. And when they go to church, they don't see the real world that they live in outside church. Mm. They've grown up in a rich, multicultural, multi-ethnic environment. And when they come to church, they see everybody that looks just like them. And they go, what is this about?
Yeah.
What is this about? Until going to church looks like the same society that you work in every day and the people you hang out with and talk to, then church is going to seem irrelevant.
Yes. I can't agree with you more. We touched on so many rich subjects we could delve into.
Yeah, we'd go a long way. Yeah.
But I want to allow our listeners and participants to chime in later. But before we go toward that, I'd like to get ready to go off into the interfaith dynamics a little bit more.
Sure.
But before we do that, I'd like for you to listen to a poem that's done by a man named Coleman Barks. And it's a poem by Rumi, the Iranian or Persian poet, spiritual, mystic person. It's a beautiful poem, but I think it might help us get a sense of at least one honest take on religions and faith. So I'm going to ask Cheyenne, if you don't mind, just to play that poem for us, and let's reflect on the words and the thoughts and the ideas behind it.
Move beyond any attachment to names. Every war and every conflict between human beings has happened because of some disagreement about names. It's such an unnecessary foolishness. Because just beyond the arguing, there's a long table of companionship set and waiting for us to sit down. What is praised is won. And so the praise is won too. Many jugs being poured into a huge basin. All religions, all this singing, one song. The differences are just illusion and vanity. Sunlight looks slightly different on this wall than it does on that wall, and a lot different on this other one. But it is still one light. We have borrowed these clothes, these time and space personalities, from a light. And when we praise, we're pouring them back in. What is praised is won. And so the praise is won too. Many jugs being poured into a huge basin. All religions, all this singing, one song. The differences are just illusion and vanity. Sunlight looks slightly different on this wall than it does on that wall, and a lot different on this other one, but it is still one light. We have borrowed these clothes, these time and space personalities, from a light. And when we praise, we're pouring them back in.
Dr. Hunt.
Yeah, that's great. Rumi is terrific. So anybody, and the Barker's translations are fabulous.
All these differences, illusions, and vanity, would you say?
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I love the opening illustration with the light looks different on different walls. Of course it does. But you can't get confused about the wall and the light. And it warms and makes them all vibrant as well, one could say. That spirit that the poem speaks of has, I think, gradually become the spirit of interfaith dialogue, although there's a lot of there are some steps along the way to this, because religions differ in the way in which they characterize that which is ultimate in the universe. And part of the issue is, are we going to focus on the things that are different, which history tells us we can argue about endlessly and come to no conclusion? Are we going to focus on the things that are the same, the things that we have in common, the common insights that we share, and learn from each other in that way? And I think that's, Rumi calls people to this. He says, yes, you worship in many different ways, but look, the praise all ends up in the same place. Right. I love that point. Thank you.
I love it too. I think we sometimes get in trouble though with the new age kind of movement to religion like a supermarket, where we take a little from this shelf, a little from that shelf, and just kind of piece it together. But what I'm learning in my old age is that if you can commit to going through and deeply with something, but at the same time, remain open and welcoming to all, but you still have a practice, or you still have a commitment toward a particular area without disrespecting other areas, but acknowledging them and embracing them as well. To me, I think that's a healthier way to go than just trying to pick and choose and based on the wind or the whim you might have for the day. How do you feel about that kind of approach?
Well, I think that's exactly right, Ernest. I've been now engaged in interreligious dialogue seriously for 40 years, mm-hmm. and in very different situations. But I think the one thing that I've seen over this entire period is that a dialogue where everybody comes in and decides to agree with everybody because they don't actually have any firm commitments to anything mm-hmm. is wasted time. And nobody wants to stay involved in that. We need to come in with our commitments and be open about our differences. Look at those things that we can discuss meaningfully with each other and what we can explore, maybe find that we have more similarities and differences. And then move on to asking, well, what do we have in common and where can we work together and have the dialogue be about that? But yeah, I learned this first in sort of serious dialogue with Muslims. And this was really when I was doing my PhD at the University of Malaya. So I had a Muslim supervisor and a Christian supervisor. And most of the students were Muslims. They just weren't interested in talking to someone who agreed with them on everything. That's not an interesting conversation. They were fascinated, though, as people who'd gotten a lot of propaganda to find out what Christians really thought and felt and experienced, as much as I was fascinated by where they were coming from and their thoughts and their ideas and the differences among them. That's what we all know makes for a rich and interesting conversation,
yeah.
Right? And I think that's really quite key. I think you've nailed it. People who come to dialogue with their own commitments and an attitude of openness and honesty will find that there's a rich conversation that will take you somewhere.
Yeah, I may be mischaracterizing this, but I think there's several levels of movements trying to bring together these conversations. There's mm-hmm. one group I heard of like you call the World Parliament of Church of Religions.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I hope you could explain or describe what that's like. And there may be some more grassroots from the earth up kind of approaches for embracing indigenous cultures and welcoming others and so forth. I think there's a dynamic coming from above, so to speak, like the World Parliament of Religions and grassroots mm-hmm. springing up as well. So do you see any kind of movement to develop and enhance the interfaith relationships?
There are several actually, and I think some very helpful ones. You know, interfaith relationships are built on a lot of different things. They're built on better mutual understanding, so that we understand these people that we live with. What are their beliefs? What are their customs? Their habits? There's talking about the things that we can do together right in a local community as people of faith. And then there's political discussions, interfaith political discussions that need to be engaged at a political level in society. If we think broadly, we can think of interfaith projects that deal with education, interfaith projects that deal with actual dialogue between people where we just get to know each other and understand each other, and then interfaith where we work on common projects together that for our society. And there's actually a lot more going on than people are aware. Well, I'm gonna start at the top where you did Parliament of the World's Religions, is what it's called officially, the Parliament of the World's Religions. This organization began back in the late 19th century, and was revitalized about 30 years ago. And since then, there has been a Parliament of the World's Religions about every 5 years. The last one being in Toronto. For anybody who can attend one of these, they're fantastic. That's all that you can say about it. you have 6 or 7 days of literally thousands of educational opportunities. You watch dialogue in action. You learn about what people are doing. You can be involved in small groups with people you never thought you would have met. And they do organize then on what we would call big global issues, the environment, the empowerment of women, migration. So they're a big and useful global organization. I won't say they're the only one, but they're maybe the most visible and the most accessible for many of us. But look, let's talk about Dallas, the Dallas area. There's been an educational opportunity for interfaith dialogue. The name of it has been Faiths in Conversation, although it's been run by 3 different groups of people in succession. And these typically 10 times a year conversations between 3 religious leaders have been going on for 15 years. There's an audience sits and listens and then can ask questions, but basically it models what it's like for people who are committed to interreligious dialogue to sit and talk with each other. Experts, by the way. Okay. Then one thing that anybody can participate in is what different synagogues and temples and mosques offer, especially to Christians, in terms of educational opportunities. And you can always learn from video shows and things from reputable sources. National Geographic's put on some great stuff like this. So I think that's, Ernest, is the educational opportunities that are readily available to people. Actual dialogue, if you're saying, I just want to get involved in talking to folks that are from a different religious faith so we can really learn something about each other and I can understand these people. That's going on in Dallas too. And I'm going to mention a few things. The Dialogue Institute of the Southwest is a institute dominantly run by Turkish Muslims, but very active in creating dialogue possibilities. Abraham's Table is one of these. They have a group that's all women in dialogue. They're very welcoming. That's the Dialogue Institute of the Southwest. A new organization called Faith Commons involves George Mason and Nancy Kasten and Omar Suleiman is engaged in creating these kinds of opportunities. If you go out to the suburbs, you have the Richardson Multi-Faith Alliance. You've got something called Faith Forward Dallas that works out of Thanksgiving Square. And Thanksgiving Square is kind of the place where the Faiths in Conversation is being organized. All of these are places where dialogue can take place. And I got to say, people can start their own. I'm speaking as a Christian now. Our non-Christian neighbors are anxious to know and to be known. And churches and even individuals can reach out to mosques and to synagogues and to gurdwaras, Sikh gurdwaras, or to Hindu temples or Buddhist temples, and find that there are plenty of opportunities to come into conversation and to learn more. And then finally, maybe we can tease some of these out because people are involved. There are places to be involved in common projects. Emily Thomas is here. We greeted her earlier of the Interfaith Foundation for Community Organizations, the work they do with peace initiatives, especially Pastors for Peace. We have here in Dallas Interfaith Family Services, a very old interfaith organization working on community projects. Dallas Area Interfaith is another similar organization to that. A national organization called the Interfaith Youth Corps, led by Ibu Patel, has local branches that one can hook into. And the truth is, you can start your own. What it takes to be engaged in interfaith projects and dialogue is ultimately a person of one faith reaching out to a person of another faith and saying, let's talk. Let's see if we can learn something about each other. Let's see what we can do together in a common project. And I would encourage all of those things. And I will add that if you don't know how to do it, if you're going, I wouldn't know how to start a conversation like that, call me at SMU. I have lots of resources on how to get an interfaith conversation started. And there's lots more that I don't have, but that are available. So that's my urging of folks is you can get involved, and we've got stuff in Dallas you can get involved in right now.
Wow, that's thrilling to know we have those kind of opportunities right here at our home, in our home base. Also thankful for you for being to offer your services to those who might want to look for a place to actually learn how to start something like that, initiate a conversation. We'd like to appreciate that. I also want to recognize Emily Thomas, who you pointed out is on board. She's with the Interreligious Foundation for Community Organization. I think that organization is about 50 to 60 years old and going strong. And one of the works they do is with a group called Pastors for Peace. So Emily, if you go around, could you kind of just highlight and abbreviate what kind of things you're doing and how people might can.
Right there on the. Yeah, thanks, Ernest. And this has been fascinating, and I've been all kinds of things are running through my head while you're talking. IFCO, interreligious, because back in 1967 when it was started, that was the term, was started out of the faith community. And we've done a lot of things in that, and it's the first foundation, the first thing that was begun and led and has been consistently all through its history, led by people of color. So they let me along, and they're very nice to me. But our director is, for many, many years, was Reverend Lucius Walker, who was a Baptist pastor. We've gone through some changes that 10 years ago, he passed on, and now his daughter took over. So Gail Walker is now our director. But Lucia and I, and I'll say my own history, Lucia's hired me for a month in 1993. And then I worked for 10 years, and then I tried to retire and I failed. So now I'm a full-time volunteer. And part of what I've learned from Lucius and in the work that IFCO has done is how important working on an interfaith basis is. And not just when we talk about people of faith and people of conscience, because as you were saying, there are many, many people who have wonderful conscience, very active, very true, very courageous, and would not claim themselves, would not define themselves as people of faith. And as you spoke to what's going on within the religious community, that they would choose to do that is an important discussion, but not the one we're having here. IFCO has done a number of different things. What we've been doing right now is a lot of our focus has been on the work with Cuba and our relationship with the faith community in Cuba and the Martin Luther King Center there and the other churches and church center, ecumenical centers in Cuba, and how we can change our foreign policy in the United States from this one that we have been trying for 60 some years to cause enough suffering in Cuba that they would change their government to the one that, like the one we used to control. So where IFCO is been doing this, one of the things we've been doing recently, and this is where Ernest and I were having this conversation several weeks ago, about working very specifically with the faith community in the United States around these and looking at different ways that we can influence our government and from a faith perspective. and other people are doing this. There's lots of ways of doing this, but I was really struck by what you were saying at the beginning of how we as a country are not spiritually prepared, both to live in a multi-faith world, a multi-racial, diverse world. And we're not prepared to live and let other people be our neighbors and have their own choices. And I agree, it's a spiritual issue. And so IFCO is saying, let's look at it from that perspective. Let's work with people of faith and about how do we change this from, because it's a spiritual problem. Yeah. I also want to just, can I do a little commercial for my own church, which is First Presbyterian Church of Brooklyn. And Brooklyn's very diverse, probably not quite as diverse as the Dallas you're describing, but we label ourselves, if you look on the firstchurchbrooklyn.org website, the wording is an intentionally inclusive and diverse Christian community. And we've followed the teachings of Howard Thurman, who began, combined the spirituality with the need for social justice. And we were also chosen, was a nice white Presbyterian church that now is intentionally diverse. And we were claimed one of the 10 best gospel choirs in New York City. So we were up against some competition there.
That's saying something, yeah.
That's saying something, exactly. It is something that is to be looked at and to be changed, both on the congregational level, so that these young people can see churches that look like the rest of their lives, as you said. And also on the activist, on the public policy, on the let's make a better world, which is where IFCO was looking. So that's, I could go on, but.
Emily, thank you for sharing the light on that. And I want everybody to check out through their website, IFCO. Is it called IFCONews.org?
IFCONews.org, IFCONews.org.
Okay. Thank you for that. We've tried some little things on our own here in Dallas. Just being neighborly with our neighbors and trying to do a community gardening and things like that, bringing people together, a diverse background, not necessarily based on your religious persuasion, but just the community needs. I was a member of a church called Munger United Methodist Church in Old East Dallas. And we tried some things ourselves for the short while we were able to carry on. And one of those was an interfaith conference. So we brought together Muslim, Jewish people, a Buddhist, Hindu, Christian, of course, and came together to celebrate our various faiths and display some of our practices, dance, music, song, and so forth. So each one had at least one or two cultural presentations to share. But I think to me, what the opening ceremony was, where we had the imam and the rabbi and the priest and the pastor stand before the audience, and in front of them was this large bowl. Each of them had a small cup, and they made their own prayer in their own way, and they poured into the large bowl. And that, to me, represented this sharing and coming together and all kind of becoming one source. So recognizing that, and I want to thank Pastor Stovall for leading that charge. And also I'm so thankful for Emily bringing the name of Reverend Lucius Walker back to the light, because his spirit lives on. And I just want to continue to celebrate him for the sacrifices and hard work he's made throughout his life, from the 60s on through the 2000s. So thank you for sharing that, Emily. We're going to open up for some questions shortly. I wonder if Cheyenne has anyone who's already indicated some questions they may have, if you could guide us through that. We have about 20 minutes or so to go. And I want to thank Robert Hunt. I hope you don't go away, continue, because the moment these questions will be directed to you and to Pastor even Emily. So stay tuned. Anybody have any questions for Cheyenne?
So we do just have one from Catherine. If you, Catherine, do you want to read your comment or comment on it further?
Would you read it for me, please?
Of course.
And then I'll comment on it.
Of course. So just says, I'm thinking that being 22 to 33 and not attending church is systemic. I'm 68 and I didn't reattend church until I started having my family about 33 years old.
I was just bouncing back off a comment that the pastor made about youth today. And I just wanted to identify that I was that youth yesterday. And I didn't attend church in my early 20s until I felt that it was something that I needed to go back to for my daughter's sake. And I'm very spiritual right now, more so than religious. And I want to just say that there is hope for those young people who are not attending church. Our father always said, church is within. And that's what we believe as a McMillan family, church is within.
Thank you. I see an old friend of mine on the web. I wonder if Omar Wally has anything he'd like to share. He's in Houston, Texas. He's led the fight for justice and equality there for many years and still involved in it. He's also an associate pastor in the Methodist Church, I believe. So, Omar Wally, if you have a word to say, it would be welcome. I guess not. Okay.
I think he's having some technical issues.
Okay. Whenever you feel ready.
Hi, yeah. I have a few words. One of the things that you did that was not recognized, I don't think, by any other, was your beginning. Your beginning of this started with acknowledgement by John Coltrane. Now, John Coltrane, it was or is, still is, a jazz musician. He was in drugs, he was in all of that. But one day he decided that he needed to find his way in life. And he went upstairs from where he lived and told his wife he won't come down until he find the answer. And when he did, he came downstairs and told his wife that he did. And he recorded this music, A Love Supreme. A Love Supreme changed so many people, not only musicians, but people around the country about religion, the way they could, you know, have religion, how they believe, what they believed. And when growing up in the North with a Southern mother who, we were Baptists, and, I went to church, Sunday school, BYPU, I conduct Sunday school classes as I got older, but it wasn't enough. I was missing something. My mother did not like the idea of jazz. Jazz was the devil's work. You know? So when you heard John Coltrane, that's the devil's work. But John Coltrane was very serious about his religion, which made many musicians, white, black, whatever, look into religion the way John Coltrane looked at it. So the Unity Church was very good for me when I started moving about the country. I started visiting many Unity churches because I did not want to be part of just an all-black church. I just felt that I had great friends who were, you know, other cultures, but they were going to Unity. So I joined a Unity church when I was in Tallahassee, Florida, and I just fell in love with what they were doing. I wrote plays for them. We wrote songs, and I had that type of liberty. And it gave me that liberty to look at the Bible in a certain different way, and having that perspective. There was another church in California, O.C. Smith, who was a great singer. He was part of the Unity Church, and I started taking classes from him. And I was so impressed with Unity, because Unity was what it was. It was Unity. It was bringing people, Black, white, whatever you were. And I liked that idea of this is, if there's a God, then there's a God who will accept all of us. And from all of that, that's how I look at religion today. Even though I do go to a church that's all Black, but yet I still congregate, and I still talk, and I still read, and I see all types of colors, all type of people. And I know that, you know, if there's a heaven, as we all do know that there is, that we'll see each other on the other side. And that's how I look at it.
Thank you. I'm wondering,
I didn't mean to talk that much. I just wanted to get that across.
Your voice is welcome. Your voice is welcome, and we hear you.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I just want to get back to some things that were brought up earlier, and thank everybody for what they said. But we're in an age of pandemic. We're socially distancing ourselves. We are doing things remote. I'm wondering what kind of new tactics or what kind of ideas we can utilize during this age of the pandemic to embrace our neighbor or to do some of that. Dr. Hunt, you mentioned several things. I wish you could either reiterate them or develop that thought a little bit more about what we can actually do, even if you're not a part of a church or an institution or organization, but as an individual, give us some tips. You say we can call you on the phone. SMU, I'm doing it right now, SMU. What kind of tips can you give us?
My first tip on this is think for a second, maybe do a small John Coltrane, go upstairs and ask yourself, what am I passionate about, that where I feel connected to that which is broad and divine and enlightening? And when I know that, then now, especially in a time of pandemic, where can I reach out to be involved with that with someone else? And, you know, churches have churches, mosques, synagogues, everybody's gone online now. So it's not like we're cut off from each other in that sense. We can do these kinds of Zoom conversations. We pick up a telephone. Actually, I know many people right now, if we're a little bit Zoomed out, we'd be happy if someone would call us on the yeah. phone. But think about that neighbor. I would say start with this. Think about that neighbor who's in need, who needs to have someone visit with them, that's of a different faith. They maybe go to a different church, and be friendly with them. That's such a good beginning. Talk to people in your neighborhood, the people who you live around. Maybe take some time for to notice and be friendly with the woman who wears a headscarf and is checking you out at the grocery store, or the person who works in the local diner where you're socially distanced, but you still see him when you do your takeout order. I would say even the driver that if you're ordering takeout food that drops it off, there's some people who are lonely, right? They're getting paid almost nothing to drive their cars all over the place and drop food off. So give them some time or a minute. Yeah, you're not developing a full interfaith dialogue. What you're saying is, from me as a human to you as a human, I care about you. And at a time like this, that's, I think, what's really needed, in a sense. But I would reach out to these organizations that I've mentioned to you, and I'll just repeat a few of them. Faiths in Conversation, A good way to start this, by the way, is just look up Thanksgiving Square in Dallas. It's a nexus of many things that are good. But faiths in conversation, we've already mentioned the Interfaith Foundation, IFCO, Faith Commons, another one in Dallas, Faith Commons, you can just look that up on the web. Go to these, look at what's going on. Oh, and Dialogue Institute of the Southwest, that's another one, Dialogue Institute of the Southwest. See what they've got going on and see where you can jump in and join them. I think is a really good place to get started. And then I think in our church, our mosque, our synagogue, whatever our religious community is, to begin to push our leaders and say, you know, really, don't we need to be a little bit broader and more open? I love the word intentionality from Emma. We don't become, sorry, I hope we're still there. I had to plug my computer back in here. I hope that we recognize that if we're going to become a more outreach-oriented, broadly inclusive group, it will mean we have to do it intentionally. We have to think about it and say, yeah, this is where I'm going, and urge our leaders to do that. I thought it was an interesting comment, you know, attending an all-African American church. And one of the reasons I think it's interesting is because one of the dynamics around this is the cultural integrity of worship versus, you know, versus inclusive communities. Not every community can be inclusive. There are communities that need to preserve their cultural integrity. I'm sure it doesn't mean that white folks aren't welcome in church, but it's going to be a different church, right? So I'd say that's one of the things to be respectful of, to recognize that there's going to be a difference between a broadly diverse congregation, ethnically or culturally, and congregations that have a certain kind of integrity. They both have their place in our society and both need to be respected. But here's the thing, they can engage in conversation with each other. They can still do stuff together. And I think that to me is the key, to look for the things that we can do together and how we can open ourselves to talk to others. But yeah, we've got these organizations in Dallas. I'd say jump on those when you can, Ernest.
I thank you for those tips, those guideposts for us to take to heart. To me, I really resonate with you saying, start where you are, you know, reflect, recognize where your talents, your strength, your compassion, your heart is, and follow that. And that'll, you can't go wrong with that. And then these other organizations are out there, should you need to link up with others. But I love the point, the starting point, it's just start where you are. My grandmother used to say, brighten the corner where you are. You know, a mantra of my family for a while, just brighten up the corner where you are. Emily and Robert, please.
I just real quick, I want to go back to your Rumi poem, because one of the places you start with is being humble, and the light shines on three different walls. The sun is not any of those walls. We're one of the walls. So we can see a part of the whole. Somebody else can see another part. If we think we've got it all, then that's heredity. We think we're God.
Yeah.
So I love the poem and thank you. I didn't know that one. And that's, but I think that's an important way of recognizing that I have a piece of the truth. You have a piece of the truth. We can talk together.
Yes. Thank you. And Shan, before we go later on, would you just tell everybody the name of that poem before we close out? Not that we close out now, just want to, so we can all kind of check it out ourselves later on. Dr. Hunt, you had something?
Well, I was going to say another thing that occurred to me in your description of what happened at Monger Place is that engagement in the arts together can be a very, very powerful thing that cuts across diverse religious lines. And I think that, you know, even if the art is something small, like a liturgical celebration, it's, you know, where you've used the symbolic language to speak. But it can also be something bigger, the creation of drama, the plastic arts. Arts are something that many different diverse cultures and religions can often gather around and appreciate among each other. We're a place with COVID that, you know, this is not so easy right now. But I think it's something that ought to be encouraged, and religious institutions that can host art venues, music, all sorts of things, really are doing the community a favor, because the arts can bring us together in ways that other things cannot.
Yes. And thanks to my experience with the Academy of Theater since 2016, yeah, I've seen the transformative power inherent mm-hmm. in the arts through dance, through poetry, through readings, through drama, all of the music and dance, all of those together are transformative. I've seen that through firsthand through working with young people who send their lives elevate, their attention span shift to more deeper understanding. Brother Ed pointed out the power of drama in his life and others. And so that's just kind of recognizing those attributes are inherent in the arts, and we can take it. Yeah, thank you for shining a light on that. I wanted to see if anybody has any more questions or comments. Cheyenne, do you have any more others?
I do not have any others in the chat or from Facebook.
Okay. Well, let me just say this to Dr. Hunt. I'm not sure what time it is there, but it's like 7:45. I think you were in the early morning. What time is it in Indiana right now?
It's just coming on to 3:00 in the morning.
Wow. Being there bright and early and bushy-tailed, sharp, on point at this ungodly hour, I might say, for you there in Austria. And I wish you continued support for you and your family as you go through this journey together. I know your grandchildren love to see you back there with them and all. So enjoy your stay there and hurry back home when you can. And I just want to thank everybody for their participation today. It's been astonishing to recognize the talents and gifts we all can contribute to this discussion. And thank you, Emily, for recognizing the need for humility through all of this. And that is a guiding light for us. I would love to close, if there are no more comments or questions, with a song by one of my favorites, Mr. Carlos Santana. But before we do close, I want to remind you that this is the third of four sessions. And tomorrow night at 6:30, we'll be joined by the great, illustrious, and candid Eva Adegwene, who's gonna, I believe, tie all these things together and help us with some new stuff to help us go forward, tying this in a sense of awareness. How can we cultivate our awareness and our act to become more active for ourselves and for others and uplifting life in our community? So again, thank you, Dr. Hunt, and everyone who's joined us tonight. And let's just pray for a restful night and a good morning tomorrow for all of us. And if we would, let's hear John Coltrane take us on home with, I believe the song is called Full Moon, right?
Yes, that is right. All right. Give me 1 second. Sorry, I thought I had it pulled up.
Okay. And we're going to have a survey coming out soon, so please respond. Help us figure out how we can make this even a better type program and learn from what you've done tonight. Thank you. Thank you all.
Is it John Coltrane or Santana that's coming up?
Santana. Carlos Santana. Thank you.
Thanks, Ernest.
Thank you. Have a great night and a good morning to you. Thank you.
Okay. Take care.
Thank you. Bye.